Hi again. As promised, we did benchmark the CPU and GPU installed on our Lenovo ThinkCentre Neo Ultra Mini PC. Some call it a business PC and others a gaming PC. It's really not a gaming PC, but it can game. It's actually geared more towards creatives and business applications, but it can game too with that NVIDIA RTX 4060 Ada generation GPU and a sweet little Core i7-14700 CPU. Like our channel? Then hit that subscribe button. Let's get to it. I will try and make this somewhat short. Again, this is not necessarily the performance of the Lenovo ThinkCentre Neo Ultra system, but the CPU and GPU that installed in that system. Oh, and just a side note, Center has the European spelling, as in Centre with an R-E instead of an E-R. Not that that's gonna make any difference to the performance. We will be measuring to a certain extent the performance of the installed CPU. The 14th generation Intel Core i7-14700 CPU and the NVIDIA RTX 4060 Ada GPU. Memory does have some impact on performance, not to mention the drive on which the games would be installed, but since we have 32 gigabytes of DDR5 memory and a quite fast little NVMe M.2, we should be good to go. As usual, we're using Cinebench R23 for the CPU benchmarking and the 3D Mark application to measure GPU performance. To be fair, the 3D Mark application also does a little CPU measurement as well. Specific modules for 3D Mark will be TimeSpy, Port Royale, Speedway, Steel Nomad, and Solar Bay. The last two are really not as intensive as the other three. In fact, the Solar Bay module is more of a measure of mobile devices. Still, I do like the graphics. Mesmerizing. As far as Steel Nomad, I'm just waiting for him or her to blow something up. Spoiler alert, that doesn't happen. First, a recap on the CPU. The Intel i7-14700 CPU installed on this system offers 28 cores with 8 performance cores, or P cores, and 12 efficiency cores, or E cores. P cores have 2 virtual threads per core, while the E cores only have 1 virtual thread per core for 28 virtual threads on the CPU. It supports DDR5 5600 memory with 33 megabytes of cache and a maximum turbo frequency of 5.2 gigahertz. This particular unit in its current configuration has 32 gigabytes of memory. With both P cores and E cores, the CPU decides how to distribute the workload to the cores best suited to handle the job. For multi-threaded performance, this CPU did really well. At least I think it did. It took about 30 seconds to fill in the sunlit breakfast nook with a score of 24,446 points. Seems kind of strange to just call them points, given all the acronyms in this industry. Raster operations under stress, or ROUSes, or something like that.
What about the ROUSes?
Rodents of unusual size? I don't think they exist.
Anyways, for the single core test, unsurprisingly, quite slow, as they all are. Just a little better than watching grass grow. Took about 6.5 minutes for that. We also left the recording running for about the same length of time from sheer boredom. I'll spare you the wait time for watching the full rendering. As a comparison, the AMD Ryzen Threadripper Pro 7995WX in the ThinkStation P8 video, link in the upper right-hand corner, was maybe a hair faster on a single core, but blazing fast on multi-core. Maybe I just have a short attention span. A little more interesting in the graphics category are the 3D Mark benchmarks for the GPU. Keep in mind our video is in 4K at 3840x2160, so this will definitely put the GPU to the test. A recap of the GPU installed. The NVIDIA RTX 4060 features 8GB of GDDR6 memory and will run all the new games. It has a power draw of 115 watts and at least a 300 watt PSU is recommended for the host system. At 350 watts, we're good to go. It has 3 DisplayPort 1.4a and 1 HDMI 2.1 port. We connected it to the 4K monitor via DisplayPort 1.4a port. It features Ada Lovelace architecture, 96 4th generation tensor cores, and DLSS 3. 24 3rd generation RT or ray tracing cores delivers twice the performance compared to the 2nd generation. It operates at a frequency of 1830 MHz, which can be boosted to 2460 MHz. The GPU is connected to the system with a PCI 4.0x8 slot and has active cooling. First up, TimeSpy. Again, these are all pretty much a test of DirectX 11, DirectX 12, DirectX 12 Ultimate is the newest of the bunch, and this card does have it. TimeSpy graphics test 1, which is right after the demo, the frame rates were at about 45 to 49 frames per second and quite smooth. Specular surfaces may be a little choppy, but still the movement was very smooth, but it was also not a fast moving scene. Graphics test 2 definitely shows faster and more abrupt movement, plus complex shapes and lighting effects. Frame rates from 40s to mid 50s at times. Last test is for the CPU. That too looked quite quick, with the little motes in the air dancing around. That said, this CPU does have Intel HD Graphics 770, which is the integrated graphics driver for the 14th generation Core i7-14700 processor. Looking at the end benchmark results, the GPU scored a 10,098 with a CPU score of 14,793. Frame rates for a variety of games and resolutions were all over the place, but still quite high for a standard gaming experience at 1440p Ultra, much higher at 1080p, but no surprises there. Here are the specs for our ThinkCentre Neo Ultra unit. From a graphics chart perspective, you can see the various tests are divided by gray vertical lines. At the very beginning, the demo, next line is test 1, then test 2, and lastly the CPU test. The top chart with the orange line indicates frame rates for tests 1 and 2, plus the CPU test at the end. The CPU performance is the next chart down measuring temperature, was a bit higher in the demo than in tests 1 and 2. Blue for the GPU, turquoise for the CPU. You can see the CPU takes over, it starts to ramp up as the GPU cools down with the CPU test at the end. Next up, Port Royale. This test is a measure of the GPU ray tracing and traditional rendering techniques. Here we're looking at the rendering of ray trace shadows, reflections, glass, and specular surfaces. I do like this test because of the assortment of materials rendered with reflections and transparencies, not to mention hostile robots. The rendering is a little slow at lower to upper 20s with a few artifacts and jags on the edges, but it does present a very realistic rendering of the surface reflections. Some surfaces are definitely a little pixelated, and the frame rates do slow down a bit with that highly reflective surface of the ship at certain points. With all the reflections, it kind of reminds me of Princess Padme's Nubian-class starship in the Star Wars prequels. This module was a little taxing for the GPU. Looking at the score of 5,592 and frame rates at an average of 25.89, you can see this module was definitely a challenge. But looking at the graphics, it still rendered quite well. That purple line for the CPU frequency, you can definitely see it fluctuating dramatically to compensate for the complex images. Again, we are recording on a 4K monitor at 3840 pixels by 2160 pixels with DPI scaling at 150%. At lower screen resolutions, you can get some high frame rates for other programs and this benchmark module too. Here we have the stats for the system, where you can see the average memory clock frequency and temperature for the GPU at 75 degrees Celsius. That is in the upper part of the stats under GPU number 1. Below is the integrated Intel UHD Graphics 770 on the CPU, but we do have a temperature reading for that too at an average of 63 degrees Celsius. Looking at the graphics below, frame rates, temperature, percentage of usage between the GPU and the CPU, and then frequency of CPU and GPU. The first part going horizontally across the graph shows the demo portion first, and then the gray line separates the actual test portion. That second graph from the bottom shows 100% usage on the GPU with the red line, the black line for the CPU. From the graph at the bottom, the CPU is definitely going through its paces to deliver with some pretty impressive fluctuations. Next, we ran Speedway. 3DMark describes this module as a ray tracing benchmark for high-end gaming PCs. The ThinkCentre Neo Ultra is really not a high-end gaming PC. We'll just start there. However, our machine does meet the requirements with a GPU that has at least 6 GB of memory. All of these tests pretty much measure the same stuff. In this case, DirectX 12 Ultimate, check. Ray traced reflections, check. Real-time global illumination, check. Mesh shaders, volumetric lighting, plus particles and post-processing effects. Those last few are kind of new, I suppose. When we looked at the frame rates for Speedway, it averaged a little over 24 frames per second and a Speedway score of 2,452. The combined graph of all the properties that are measured again shows the CPU with that purple line going through its paces. You can see it is hitting that max turbo frequency range at up to 5.3 gigahertz, or since the graph is using megahertz, that would be 5,300 megahertz. I'm going to assume it's using the performance cores, given the base frequency never goes below the stated base frequency of those P cores at 2.1 gigahertz or 2100 megahertz on this graph. You can also see the various potential frame rates for a few games at 1440p Ultra and 1080p. Here again, the system information is basically the same with a slightly different temperature reading at 69 degrees Celsius on the GPU. Then the graphical breakdown of the information you saw in the overlay graph a few minutes ago. Frame rates pretty consistent in the mid-20s. Temperature of the GPU continued to rise at a steady, but not drastic rate. Definitely 100% usage on the GPU throughout the test. And we tried the Deep Learning Super Sampling, or DLSS 3.0, for the Port Royale module. DLSS is designed to improve frame rates and, in general, image quality using AI and the benefits of deep learning. The first test is without DLSS to establish a baseline. At baseline, we were getting like 1.5 frames per second, which is pathetic. With DLSS, it averaged in the 40 frames per second range at the end of the test. It does that by reconstructing higher resolution frames and inserting them into the flow. In this case, lots of them. Again, output resolution is with a 4K monitor, so we did not even get the 8K resolutions. Lastly, Steel Nomad is kind of a general test using DirectX 12 Ultimate and is for high-end gaming systems. It is a non-ray-traced benchmark, but does test the reliability, stability, and sustained performance of your system. I really have not explored this module much. And there you have it. Both the processor and the GPU performed quite well in the modules, but not really that surprising. It does have an NVIDIA RTX 4060 GPU with 8 GB of memory, and that Intel Core i7-14700 CPU is quite nice too. It's good for stable performance, but not the best option for gaming, if you want overclocking capabilities like with the i7-14700K version. However, that is not listed as one of the configuration options for this system, which is really more suited towards a crossover business gaming combo thing. Pretty sure it would also affect the limited thermal design point for the system, as these processors are known to run a bit hot. If you are looking for servers, professional workstations, CPUs, GPUs, or anything else, check out itcreations.com. Until next time, I'm Doug Stuman with IT Creations, and thanks for watching.